Melinda presents this unabridged recording of The Dare Game, written by Jacqueline Wilson and read by Sandi Toksvig.
I'm Tracy Beaker, the great inventor of extremely outrageous dares, and I dare you not to say this is the most brilliant story ever. I thought I was going to live happily ever after with Cam as my foster mum. Well, ha ha, it hasn't turned out like that. Cam's so mean. She won't buy me designer clothes, so all the other kids at my new school laugh at me. No wonder I bunk off and go to this special secret place. There are these two boys I meet there, Alexander and Football. We play this dare game. And I always win. I'm the greatest. I am. No home. You know that old film they always show on the telly at Christmas? The Wizard of Oz? I love it. Especially the Wicked Witch of the West, with her cackle and her green face and all her special flying monkeys. I'd give anything to have a wicked winged monkey as an evil little pet. It could whiz through the sky, flapping its wings and sniffing the air for that awful, stale, instant coffee and talcum powder teacher smell. And then it would swoop straight onto Mrs. Vomit Bagley and carry her away screaming. That'll show her. I've always been absolutely tip-top at writing stories. But since I've been at this stupid new school, Mrs. V.B. just puts a disgracefully untidy work, Tracy, and check your spellings. Last week, we had to write a story about night time, and I thought it an unusually cool subject, so I wrote 8.5 pages about this girl out late at night, and it's seriously spooky. And then this crazy guy jumps out at her and almost murders her, but she escapes by jumping in the river, and then she swims right into this bloated corpse, and then when she staggers onto the bank, there's this strange, flickering light coming from the nearby graveyard. And it's an evil occult sect wanting to sacrifice an innocent young girl, and she's just what they're looking for. It's a truly great story. Better than any that Cam could write. I'll tell you about Cam in a minute. I'm sure it's practically good enough to get published. I typed it out on Cam's computer so it looked ever so neat, and the spell check took care of all the spellings, so I was all prepared for Mrs. V.B. to bust a gut and write, "Very, very, very good indeed, Tracy. 10 out of 10 and triple gold star, and I'll buy you a tube of Smarties at playtime." Do you know what she really wrote? "You've tried hard, Tracy, but this is a very rambling story. You also have a very warped imagination." I looked up warp in the dictionary she's always recommending, and it means to twist out of shape. That's spot on. I'd like to warp Mrs. Vomit Bagley, twisting and twisting until her eyes pop and her arms and legs are wrapped right round her great big bum. That's another thing. Whenever I write the weeniest, babiest little rude word, Mrs. V.B. goes bananas. I don't know what she'd do if I used really bad words like and censored. I looked up ramble too. I liked what it said. To stroll about freely as for relaxation with no particular direction. So that's exactly what I did today, instead of staying at boring old school. I bunked off and strolled round the town freely, as relaxed as anything. I had a little potter in paper chase and bought this big, fat, purple notebook with my pocket money. I'm going to write all my mega-manic, ultra-scary stories in it, as warped and as rambly as I can make them. And I'll write my story too. I've written all about myself before in The Story of Tracy Beaker. So this can be The Story of Tracy Beaker 2. Or Find Out What Happens Next to the Brave and Brilliant Tracy Beaker. Or Further Fabulous Adventures of the Tremendous, Terrific Tracy Beaker. Or Read More About the Truly Terrible Tracy Beaker, Even More Wicked Than the Wicked Witch of the West. Yes, I was telling you about The Wizard of Oz. There's only one bit that I truly dread. I can't actually watch it. The first time I saw it, I very nearly cried. I don't cry, though. I'm tough, as old boots. New boots? The biggest, fiercest, reinforced Doc Martens. It's the bit right at the end where Dorothy is getting fed up with being in Oz. Which is mad, if you ask me. Who'd want to go back to that boring black and white Kansas and be an ordinary kid where they take your dog away when you could dance round Oz in your ruby slippers? But Dorothy acts in an extremely dumb manner all the way through the film. You'd think she'd have sussed out for herself that all she had to do was click those ruby slippers and she'd get back home. That's it. That's the bit where she says, "There's no place like home." It gets to me, because there's no place like home for me. No place at all. I haven't got a home. Well, I didn't have up until recently, unless you count the home. If a home has a capital letter at the front, you can be pretty sure it isn't like a real home. It's just a dumping ground for kids with problems. The ugly kids, the bad kids, the daft kids, the ones no one wants to foster, the kids way past their sell-by date, so they're all chucked on the rubbish heap. There were certainly some ultra-rubbishy kids at that home, especially a certain Justine Littlewood. We were deadly enemies once, but then we made up. I even gave Justine my special Mickey Mouse pen. I rather regretted this, actually, and asked for it back the next day, pretending it had just been a loan, but Justine wasn't having any. There are no flies on Justine. No wasps, bees, or any kind of bug. It's weird, but I kind of miss Justine now. It was even fun when we were deadly enemies and we played the dare game. I've always been great at thinking up the silliest, daftest, rudest dares. I always dared everything and won until Justine came to the children's home. Then I still won. Most of the time. I did. But Justine could certainly invent some seriously wicked dares herself. I miss her. I miss Louise too. And I especially miss Peter. This is even weirder. I couldn't stand weedy old Peter when he first came to the home. But now it feels like he was my best ever friend. I wish I could see him. I especially wish I could see him right now, because I'm all on my own. And although it's great to be bunking off school, and I found the most brilliant hiding place in the whole world, it is a little bit lonely. I could do with a mate. When you're in care, you need to make all the friends you can get because you don't have much family. Well, I've got family. I've got the loveliest, prettiest, best ever mum in the whole world. She's this dead famous Hollywood movie star, and she's in film after film, in so much demand that there isn't a minute of the day when she can see me, so that's why I'm in care. Who am I kidding? Not you. Not even me. I used to carry on like that when I was little, And some kids took it all in and even acted like they were impressed. But now, when I come out with all that movie guff, they start to get this little curl of the lip. And then the minute my back's turned, I hear a splutter of laughter. And that's the kinder kids. The rest tell me straight to my face that I'm a nutter. They don't even believe my mum's an actress. I know for a fact she's been in some films. She sent me this big, glossy photo of her in this negligee. But now kids nudge and giggle and say, "What kind of film was your mum in, Tracy Beaker?" So I duff them up. Sometimes, literally, I'm very handy with my fists. Sometimes I just pretended in my head. I should have pretended inside my head with Mrs. Vomit Bagley. It isn't wise to tell teachers exactly what you think of them. She gave us this new piece of writing work this morning about my family. It was supposed to be an exercise in autobiography. It's really a way for the teachers to be dead nosy and find out all sorts of secrets about the kids. Anyway, after she's told us all to start writing this my family stuff, she squeezes her great hips in and out the desks till she gets to me. She leans over until her face is hovering a few inches from mine. I thought, for one seriously scary second, she was going to kiss me. "Of course, you write about your foster mother, Tracy," she whispers, her tic-tac minty breath tickling my ear. She thought she was whispering discreetly, but every single kid in the room looked up and stared. So I stared straight back and edged as far away from Mrs. V.B. as I could and said firmly, "I'm going to write about my real mother, Mrs. Bagley." So I did. Page after page. My writing got a bit sprawly, and I gave up on spelling and stopped bothering about full stops and capital letters because they're such a waste of time. But I wrote this amazing account of me and my mum. Only I never finished it. Because Mrs. V.B. does another grand tour of the class, bending over and reading your work over your shoulder in the most off-putting way possible. And she gets to me and leans over, and then she sniffs inwards and sighs. I thought she was just going to have the usual old nag about neatness and spelling and punctuation. But this time she was miffed about the content, not the presentation. "You and your extraordinary imagination, Tracy," she said in this falsely sweet, patronising tone. She even went tut-tut, shaking her head, still with this silly smirk on her face. "What do you mean?" I said, sharpish. "Tracy, don't take that rude tone with me, dear." There was an edge to her voice and all. "I did my best to explain about autobiography. It means you tell a true story about yourself and your own life." "It is true. All of it," I said indignantly. "Really, Tracy," she said. And she started reading bits out, not trying to keep her voice down now, revving up for public proclamation. "My mum is starring in a Hollywood movie with George Clooney and Tom Cruise and Brad Pitt, and they all think she's wonderful and want to be her boyfriend. Her new movie is going to star Leonardo DiCaprio as her younger brother, and she's got really matey with Leonardo at rehearsals, and he's seen the photo of me she carries around in her wallet, and he says I look real cute and wants to write to me." Mrs. V.B. read out in this poisonous, high-pitched imitation of my voice. The entire class collapsed. Some of the kids practically wet themselves laughing. Mrs. V.B. had this smirk puckering her lips. "Do you really believe this, Tracy?" she asked. So I said, I really believe that you're a stupid, hideous old bag who could only get a part in a movie about blood-sucking vampire bats. I thought for a moment she was going to prove her bat-star qualities by flying at my neck and biting me with her fangs. She certainly wanted to. But she just marched me out of the room instead and told me to stand outside the door because she was sick of my insolence. I said she made me sick, and it was a happy chance that her name was Mrs. V. Bagley. The other kids might wonder whether the V stood for Vera or Violet or Vanessa, but I was certain her first name was Vomit, and dead appropriate too, given her last name, because she looked like the contents of a used vomit bag. She went back into the classroom when I was only halfway through, so I said it to myself, slumping against the wall and staring at my shoes. I said I was thrilled to bits to miss out on her lesson because she was boring, boring, boring and couldn't teach for toffee. She couldn't teach for fudge, nougat, licorice or Turkish delight.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.